Hello and welcome to Pro Wrestling 101. I am your host, JP John Paz. With me today is the man who's doing some shadow boxing right now. He is known as Hot Hands Hamin himself, Ben Hamin from the Hamin Media Group. Welcome. How are you doing today, sir?
JP, good to be back with you, man. I just got out of the gym. I'm feeling good. Did my Lomachenko virtual pad combo, so I'm still wound up, ready to go, man. But glad to be back here. Two-man power tripping on Pro Wrestling 101, one of my favorite shows of the week that I get the opportunity to jump in on, man. I had a great time at Immortal Championship Wrestling last weekend with the Greeks and the Sheiks, GGP, my man Blaze Haram and Megan Bain, and of course the man himself. Not just the coolest, not just the best, but my dude Justin Credible in the house. It was good to see him. And Moose has been in my backyard a lot lately with 2CW and Immortal. And I think he's coming to NYWC. So he wants a shot. I owe him one from spearing me. So he better watch his back if he comes in hacker's territory. I'm here. So my hands are ready. My hands are ready for anybody.
Nice. I love it. Did you wrestle Justin Credible, by the way?
No, he was in a five-way elimination match, or was it five or six? Six-way elimination for the King's Ransom, which is like a Money in the Bank title shot. But he didn't win. Mike Skyros beat out Bobby Ocean in the end, and it was good match to kick off the show, man. People were really with it. It was a hot match, and Justin comes out with a kendo stick. People pop. You know how it is. but always good to see my brother in person there, man. I don't want to mark out or nothing like that. When Justin Credible's like, "Hey, Hamin," I was like, "Yeah." He's like, "Come take a picture with me." I'm like, "Oh, dude, like, what more do I want in my career?" You know what I mean?
Far
like that, you know, like that shit to me. Coming up as an ECW fan, and even the first time I met Big Sal at Broadway Markets in Buffalo, when my buddy Hooch was still alive and we were producing his comedy album, Jesus Christ, I was 97. And, you know, I met Justin there and Balls Mahoney, rest in peace too, man. And they were all just great, fun loving guys. I couldn't have dreamed really where I'd be. I guess I could have. I always had big aspirations 24 years after that, 25 years after that, you know, getting selfied out with the man himself, PJ Polacco. Good weekend, man, with good brothers.
Nice. And Megan Bain, I love her look. I love everything about her. I think she's a star in the making. Just when you look at it, some indie talents, you're like, yeah, they need to change this, change that. Just looking at her, you're like, oh my God, that girl's a star already. She should bring that gimmick to wherever she gets signed to.
I mean, her and GGP together are money as a power Greek couple, you know. GGP kicked the indies right now. Everybody's champion, going around with three belts, ribbed himself as being champ of three companies.
Got to carry him around.
But well-earned. If there's a guy you want at the top of your card who can have a great match with anybody, it's GGP, and he puts over his Greek pride. And out here, she comes looking like the skies opened up and a goddess comes down, and she can wrestle her ass off. Trained by Damian Adams, who's a Rip Rogers guy. Also trained
Diana Perrazzo,
Karen Q, and a host of others. Like, his niche is kind of finding these girls who have work ethic, who are very sexy, but trains them like you want to be a macho man level wrestler. And when the bell rings, his girls can go, bro. They can go. And Megan Bain had a phenomenal match versus Valerie. Oh, God damn it. I can't remember her last name, but she had a little boy toy with her and he was wearing pink panties out there matching stuff. And I came out and grabbed him with the flag by the throat and dragged him out to cause a distraction. And then boom, Megan Bain hits the finish on her and it's Greeks up, you know? So we had a good time. Blaze Haram beats Ranger Rick Recon again in a last man standing with a little help from GGP and I, and then Megan Bain helped GGP out. So everybody's got everybody's back at Immortal when that's the Sheiks and the Greeks on top. All the gold. And I'm the 24/7 9/11 Dippin' Donuts champion. And I may have given referee Sideburns a Death Valley driver and then Dimitri from Dippin' Donuts, the sponsor, a Death Valley driver and a camel clutch and got suspended. So we'll see. We'll see how things work out.
Jeez, what the hell's going on over there?
Yeah, it's all going on at Immortal right now. And big, big show on November 20th, man. Fandango's coming. Vicky Guerrero, GGP. I'm supposedly suspended. You never know what's going to happen. Obviously, Megan Bain will be there. All big Hoss matches. A lot's going down, man. So the show's just getting bigger and bigger as the year goes on, and excited about it. I think that's in Schenectady, New York, on November 20th.
They seem to draw pretty good. From what I've seen, they draw pretty well.
Yeah, we have been. This last show was a little tough because it was Halloween weekend, but it seemed like during the first match, another 35 people showed up. So where it was bare spots, it wasn't, you know. And this show had Moose, AC Baby, Fox Vineyard, like a lot of guys you see on AEW Dark and whatnot too. So we got a really solid roster in the Northeast of guys when they're not booked one place, and girls, you know, absolutely. A lot of competent, solid wrestlers right now who started 5 or 6 years ago and are really getting it. And then there's kind of the holdover of the two CW originals. And we always got each other's back because we've been working together for a decade straight, you know. So
as far as Pro Wrestling 101 today, got another request. I love getting requests.
Okay.
I wanted you to talk about theme music and songs and music in wrestling. So I know you love your music, but I think that's a good one. I like that one. I didn't even think about that one. I was like, oh yeah, that's true. Obviously there's got to be more of a backstory to like the theme song. So when did actually it start? I mean, Michael Hayes always says Freebirds. Everyone always says he's wrong, but he's insistent that it was the Freebirds that started the theme songs in wrestling.
Maybe popularizing it, but who was actually first one to have a boombox or cassette recorder hooked up to the PA and put something out there?
Right.
That history question, I don't know the answer to off the top of my
head. Yeah, me neither. I couldn't find it. There's always people like, no, it was this, no, it was that. And then everyone's saying, like, this person's wrong. Like, even Michael Hayes, it kept coming up. And it's like, no, he's wrong. They're not.
That's your guys' homework. Let's do this. Hit him up at @2manpowertrip, @bin_Hamin. I know we got some hardcore wrestling historians out there. If Michael Hayes is claiming it, then you know the rib is in. So who before them was playing entrance music? I got to believe like a Gorgeous George or somebody way early on would have had something. You know what I mean?
You can see that. Yeah, some classical shit. Yep.
Maybe that's just in our heads, but I wouldn't doubt that some promoter hired a three-piece violin and cello and something else to be there and play him out, you know, like maybe that was his idea too. So very interesting. But before, you know, just to lay it down, why I'm interested in music, or I mean, it's obviously our common bond as human beings. I'm not way over the top about it, but I went to school for music for a lot of years, you know, like, so everything from competitions and solo competitions and sight reading, music's definitely been in my life in a massive, massive way in my early artistic career. Cause that's one of the few ways you have to, you know, have an outlet, I guess, and an identity. So, theme songs going back, and any song going back, I don't care if it's a non-wrestling theme song, if it's an 80s TV show and you hear Different Strokes, or you hear, you know, anything like that.
Airwolf,
you hear just a good old boys never meaning no harm, like, you know, like it just triggers, it takes you to Saturday morning cartoons and all that nostalgia vibe that we grew up in the 80s, man. So music was obviously taking off massive ever since kind of its inception of the record player and whatnot in homes. I don't need to do a musicology course here, but the popularity of it to then attach it to a character or a brand or a show was the identity of it. And whether it was Hayes or not, it's a brilliant move to have each guy have their own thing, because it's a Pavlovian conditioned response. And all you need to hear is wow, 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 and you know, Brock Lesnar's coming. And you're like, somebody's getting fucked up. You know what I mean? Like, or anything that could be an annoyance, will instantly trigger a response, and you're over before you ever even have to even come out, because of how conditioned the audience can be to your theme music and what hitting that theme music at the right time can do for a scene to like interrupt and send things in a different way. So the use of theme music in a show is essential. And especially with Baby Faces Up, if Hogan's in the ring doing the pose down and the confetti's dropping and you want it to go on for 4 minutes, you keep it looped and keep it going, you know? So, and all you hear after here is time to play the game. And the fucking crowd comes, everyone just stands up. They just stands up, hearing the sound of shattering glass breaking. Everybody's looking, here he comes, and fucking middle fingers go up, right? Here, and I think I'm cute, I know I'm sexy. All you need to hear is two cat calls, and you instantly have a response in your head, you know? So the power of it is unbelievable when it comes to the crowd control of, I need a response here, baby or heel. And before they even walk out, I can set the tone and set the mood. And sometimes after the music, when a run-in happens, it seems more serious. The worst run-ins are like matches going on, hit the music, everybody in the match stops. What? Like, and fucking, it's so wrestling phony. Like Stevie always likens it to NFL. Imagine if somebody in the crowd started playing music and both teams were like, what is that? And the fucking, right. You know, it's that it just makes it stupid, but there's definitely a real power to it. And something that people look forward to. And then in the 90s with all those albums, I mean, even in the 80s with Pile Driver and, you know, the SummerSlam CD with some Never Been a Right Time to Say Goodbye, one of the best worst songs of all time.
Yep.
You know, but then when you hit that Attitude Era, you can bump that CD from 93 and 95 with, you know, the Broods theme on it and all that kind of shit. Like, you can throw that in and Sexual Chocolate theme on there. You're, well, it's right. You're like,
right.
We're off to the races, man. So the music is super powerful, in my opinion, in the entire feeling of the show and where you want to use it. And after a big heel thing, all you need is a big baby face music to fucking really turn that crowd from where they were to the other side of it. And there's not aside from McMahon's, there's not many who are using it. I guess Tony Khan is really into it too, because he's spending the money on the tracks. Because what was beautiful, and I love the piracy of it, because I'm all about stealing media, unless it's from Hamin Media, then please pay me. But
right, of course.
Yeah. You know, when Paul E was using real music, that's the culture, man. You know what I mean? That bootleg underground shit. But Khan's doing it and he's showing support for his guy, whether it's Jungle Boys with the I can't think of the name of the song. I can think of the melody in my head, but I don't know.
Tarzan Boy.
Yeah, is that what it is? And then Orange Cassidy has the Pixies, right? And then Wild Thing for Moxley. So there is things that is preserving, which I like that, because it was corny kind of to go back to WWE with some of the themes after you've seen Tommy Dreamer come out to Alice in Chains. You know what I mean? Like, or Rob Van Dam, and the whole crowd is respect. I mean, dude, you're old. They got their money's worth. You came out. All you had to do is spin around and go like this. And fucking the whole crowd is the testosterone is everywhere. All these scumbags and fucking they get to do their chant along, man. So it's that participation, or Sandman with the beers, you know, and getting over in your entrance, that can really, if your match is going to suck, like mine usually does, putting the flag. So here's what I do. And sorry if I'm going on here, John, but like, you know, when I come out, so this is one reason why I think this doesn't get flagged, because I say that now and watch it get flagged. But when we first started in OVW, we came out just to call to Islamic prayer, straight up, you know, just like what happens six times a day. And then Apocalypse, or Rick Victor from Ascension, says, who's a huge Danzig fan. That guy's a huge music fan, man, when it comes to metal and, like, you know, all that Ricky Rackman shit that used to be back in the day. But he loves all that stuff, Danzig especially. And he's like, Pop, so this song, I think it would be good for you. It's like Evil. It's called Fire Mass. And so I just took the beginning of Call of Islamic Prayer and mixed it with this. And this was my theme for Oh, it still is kind of, I guess, for like 12 years. Hold on here. Now I botched the spot. But you guys know it. It was how we open every show. But during that opening, I put my flag through the curtain and it just hangs there. You know what I mean? And people know, like, even on the indies, that's my thing. And they know. And instantly we got them. They're like, their anticipation is built. What's he going to come out and say? The flag going through alone during that, they hate it. So that's how I do my little thing on the indies with that. But I love that hard-hitting theme music. And I get a lot of people saying, man, your fucking entrance theme is a banger. What is it? Because it's such a B-side Danzig track that, you know.
Not people not, know it, yeah.
No. So thanks to Rick Victor, man, for that one. But then my other theme music that I've been using is custom, because I've been lucky to work with a lot of great MCs here in upstate New York. Like, the rap scene is, it's like 97 all over again. And there's so many awesome MCs, but my one dude, Rated R, made a custom song for me. If you're cool with it, I'll lay some of it out here.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. So we gotta have this.
Put you in the camel clutch, crack his line like a touch, sideline, ringside, paralyzed, fuck a crutch, cause you're gonna need a wheelchair. Been I mean with the overkill, smash your baby face with a steel chair. The square circle, you'll get killed there. Black and blue when you turn a purple, leak it red when it spilled there. A bill fair, catching heat with the crowd, just another vicious heel down the cheat and he's proud. Hear the screams when allowed, the reading out his palms. Fuck your book of songs when the dirty saw he's dropping bombs. Ain't police with batons, but he's pro martial law. You speak if Fidel, catch a partial to your jaw, bowing down to a law. Just pray you're not a victim. Equipped with a stable just in case he's got a sick him. No title when he strips him. He'll vacate the champ. Sabotage him backstage. Bash his face on the ramp.
Rated R CNY. Get at him. Give him a follow. Tell him Hacker Hamin sent you.
So how important do you think the theme song is to the wrestler? Is it paramount? If you have a bad song, is it hurt the guy?
And they'll do it on purpose. Let's talk Killer Cross for a minute. How phenomenal was his NXT entrance and having his lady, I think, even wrote that song, and a huge, awesome entrance stage picture. And then whatever heat they claim is or isn't there, whatever. I'm not here to get into that because I'm a huge Killer Cross guy. I think there's millions of dollars written on him and major movie money too. To prove the point, what do? Without us, you're nothing. Take away his girl. Hot as hell. Not on any roster. Now we got to reintroduce her all again. Take away his music. Comes out to some generic shit that's on a keyboard that you could buy at Walmart probably right now, right? And no fucking flashing, lightning, apocalypto. Like, you've conditioned your audience that this guy gets over in this awesome entrance at NXT. Now you're going to the big show. They watch him on the other show. They're aware of him, and you strip all that magic back just to fuck with the guy. Like, that's how powerful music in your entrance can really be on the other side of that coin. If they want to fuck with you, like they do everybody for some reason, instead of getting max value out of their investment in a once in 10 year performer, that guy is, in my opinion, you know? So and it can help make a guy. It can, but there's some things where it doesn't make you, but it lives on as legendary wrestle crap. What's your favorite wrestle crap, the entrance theme?
Oh man, there's, I don't know, like a bunch of good ones. For some reason, the Doink one as the baby face, I always thought, like, oh my God, that's just like, obviously feel like you're at the carnival and I get it, but it's just like, oh man, it's just. Yeah. Sasha Banks' old theme was awful. That's bad. Dolph Ziggler's theme is terrible. I mean, there's a bunch of, I feel like a lot of the newer ones stink. Miz is terrible, obviously.
Oh, this is my favorite. He's a man.
Oh, Regal, such yeah.
A man. A real man's man.
Love that song. Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah.
But like, that's legendary right now. And the, and he would come out in the Daisy Dukes and a fucking hard hat on.
There had to be a rib on him, right?
Oh, please, bro. Of course. And you go out and you make the most out of it. And you know, where is he now? I mean, one of the most respected workers in the history of the business. So, but it's things like that, or, oh yeah, it's sexual, baby. Like, you know, like all that stuff. Or, but when you hear the whole train, up they come, bro.
Yep.
So, all that, as far as I'm concerned, I love the, even if you just hear the words, never been a right time to say goodbye. If you're a diehard wrestling track fan, you know that song, and it's so bad that you know, this Bret Hart breakup song that from the SummerSlam album. It's a beautiful thing that brings us all together. Or Vince McMahon, Stand Back, you know, like, or Vince McMahon, No Chance in Hell. You hear the first boom, no chance, that, and then boom, here comes the money. They know the Pavlovian, give them the hook right out of the gate. That's an important thing in breaking it down, actually, if you want to talk music.
Yeah.
In the most basic thing, you start out with your chorus or your hook and then come back, do your lyrics. So when the hook comes back around, the audience is already conditioned to that tonic, and then they're with the song. That's just kind of how our brains work and the way we like the fundamentals of music, along with the 1, 4, and 5 chords together. Okay. I know this is a lot of music theory, but like, this is you know, the breakdown of really how to write a simple song that is going to be everlasting. And once you have that formula, then you can plug that into how many different genres. It doesn't matter, you know what I mean? Right, and out he comes running like crazy, but we know that. Or Respect. I mean, even though that's a Pantera song, you know, as soon as it hits, you feel that. Or the Metallica riff, like when before Sandman comes out. So,
yeah, I feel like some of them immediately you get hit with it. Austin with the glass breaking. I mean, immediately everybody stands up. Warrior, bump. But everybody stands up to Hogan. Dun, 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 dun. Like, immediately everybody's up. What a rush. I mean, they all always start off like hot. It's like, oh, shit.
It's very Pavlovian, bro. It's very. And I know I always take things conspiracy wise, but the Nazis pioneered a lot of this, bro. Like, they did this in experiments of what people respond to and conditioned responses, and how do tie countries together through propaganda, through you know, look at, we stole my country because of thee, from God save our you know, like, we do the same thing, and it's been going on to where our anthem, even our high school song. Do you remember your high school song?
No, I don't.
Oh, really? I do, but maybe I was a little chorus geek. But fucking you know, everything that they want to tie tribute to, whether it's the Pledge of Allegiance or what have you, if you add some kind of cadence or prayer to it, or tie that in a branding way to it, it definitely strengthens the fanaticism, because it becomes, please rise for the national anthem. It becomes, you know, Americana. It becomes part of our conditioning just to do that type of shit every single day. So, and we're trained to do it from a very young age. You got to sing these songs at Christmas, you know, whatever it is,
man. Yeah. I love watching like old school wrestling. Like, you just watch the crowd sometimes to do the far shot. Yeah. And as soon as the music hits, you either see everybody standing up, or you see all the kids running towards like the entrance way to get the five. I love that, because it's like, din, din, everyone's like, oh, yeah. They, like, it's like almost like ingrained in their head. Like, I'm going to stand up. Oh, like, they don't even realize, like, oh shit, Hogan. Oh yeah.
Yeah, well, Rey Mysterio, Jeff Hardy, you're right. They come running, and you want that for your baby faces, for that interaction, you know? So that's a beautiful piece of what we get to do for crowd. When we say we're working people, that's all part of it. You know what I mean? Like, build the tension, build the tension, build the tension until the baby face music hits for the run-in and the crowd goes nuts. How far do we need to take it, and where is that point before we hit ready, set? You're good in gorilla. We're going 3, 2, go now. And fucking, and out he runs. He's fucking GGP's pumped, you know, whatever, dude. And that's all part of a great experience backstage producing it, because when you hear them come up, you're like, we fucking work together. We got them. We've built business this long. They followed it. There's enough heat on this guy. And then here comes this superstar to fucking clean house. You know what I mean? So it can really help make somebody, absolutely. And it can also ruin a good time when people are pumped and Dick Justice is out doing his thing or doing some Dusty Road shit, and you hit my stuff and the crowd's like, fuck, shut up, I don't want to hear you, I was just having fun. It's how we're going to pull the rug out from underneath them. And in that intro music, if you're conditioned to it, is definitely a great card to play.
So WWE, obviously, they play a huge role in like who's deciding, picking the song. Like, for instance, Killer Cross, you're mentioning, it's like, okay, you're not using your cool NXT theme. Keith Lee, you're not using your NXT theme. We're going to give you some generic crap. But Baylor, we're going to give you your awesome NXT theme where everybody gets into it and they literally remember, do-do-do-do, and the light comes on, do-do-do-do. Like, it's funny, and like, how that gets decided.
They came up because they came up with it, maybe, and the other ones, they didn't and got it over themselves. And I don't know, there's a variety, I think, of heat reasons why they do that for people instead of letting them go and do that, like a Cross or a Bearcat, you know, to test them to see if they're going to be pissed off or if they thought they were. It's mainly if you think you're over, they want to show you with everything that you're not over, and they're going to take everything away from you to make you feel small as fuck. Are you going to be able to weather that storm with a smile on your face until they give it back, where they're now going to make Killer Cross into more of a spy type figure? Oh, no shit. The guy's a walking Jason Statham in wrestling, bro. Like, what the fuck do you want more?
Yeah.
What's a better promo than Jason Statham off the top of his head? So, like, why would you strip him back instead of bringing him in right out of the gate as a high-level player is beyond me. Well, it's not beyond me. It's because they're petty. They're petty bastards. But with Finn Balor, they probably came up with it. But then, you know what? They might with Finn Balor. I can't remember who was doing it first, so I could be just talking out my ass here. But I know that Sean Spears came up with the perfect 10 thing. And Vince is like, I don't get it. Meanwhile, the crowd is sure fucking getting it. And isn't it identical to what Finn's thing kind of is? And did that happen? Was Finn's before that or not? That's another one you can tweet us at @2manpowertrip @bin_Hamin. Was that in response to that? And then taking one step further, Bobby Roode, they just repeated that and put that on him with the glorious thing. And then they just stopped doing it. I mean, it's a goddamn criminal activity shame of what they are not doing with Bobby Roode. Hey, who, a guy who should be in your top five easily, you know what I mean? And Dolph Ziggler obviously is their guy who can work with anybody, but you know, all those things of those guys getting over in their entrance, those guys don't really need to get over in their entrance because they're sexy body wrestlers who fucking can go in the ring, but they also have that too, and they pimp it out when they need it, but they really don't get the most out of it ever, you know?
Feels like it's all about picking the right themes. Like, if you kill a guy, it's, you know, as soon as the entrance, but you got to make sure you're picking the right theme for the right guy. You know what I mean? Like, Shane Douglas loves Kiss forever, but he shouldn't come out the Kiss. He should come out the Perfect Strangers. Taz can come out the Kiss. It just fits. It's weird. You know what I mean? It just, some songs work for some guys.
You think Taz coming out the Kiss works? All right. Yeah.
Well, his theme is War Machine, really.
That's true. Yeah. I was thinking of the countdown. I was like, but that you have a great point there. Absolutely. But I think what a guy believes in and what sounds ominous or like what it is I love that Wu-Tang shit. And that Rated R theme is the same boom bap and the hardcore grit New York hip hop style. That shit gets me hyped backstage. It gets me hyped every time I hear it that someone would even make a piece of art around me. You know, I didn't even ask him to, but the guy's he's got 14 albums. So he's a seasoned vet in this shit. But that a guy's going to believe in his stuff more if it's a piece of him and it represents him, and he can believe in the character because now he believes in the whole stage picture before he goes through the curtain. It's all happening and they can be more in the moment. And instead of like, you got to hit the mark here, put your arms up and do this, like that. Okay. That stuff works for Balor and whatnot. But like, if a guy's rock and roll, that's why Dirty Dogs and them come out to that, like, 1980s metal type shit, because Ziggler loves Motley Crue and all that shit. That's what he lives for. He wants to be that. So it works for him. AJ Styles coming out to hip hop is interesting, right? Like, it works, but I think that AJ's into hip hop, if I'm not wrong. That's why he believes in it, as opposed to like, let's just put some hip hop on this country boy, you know? So guy's music should definitely represent like what he is. Now there's corny ones now with Apollo Crews, like you hear the native drums and shit, you know, yeah, what I mean? You're like, oh, okay, bro, like I guess we're still doing it while these guys are in their 70s and racist as fuck, like, okay. But I like Bobby Lashley's new one, like there's some good. You, if you're a big ass kicker who can shake the world, then your music needs to represent that, right? If you're a pop culture girl who skips to the ring and you're a bitch, then you need to kind of have that, you know, whatever it is, fast money music, I guess, you know what I mean? Whether it's Sweetie in them or if it kind of sounds like Spice Girls or whatever, you know, something that's familiar. If it's not the actual thing that's in that genre, they'll represent your character. You should be able to narrow your sound down. Really, your sound should almost be like a piece of your gear. It should match your personality and what you're trying to do to reinforce that stage picture. And then we've also seen it as of late be used to hurt guys, like we talked about as well. You know, and I'm sure there was a lot of guys who got WWE music and were like, what the fuck? Like, this isn't me at all, you know, and it was just sitting on the shelf and they figured they'd try and use it. And I'm sure there's guys they thought would get over because of their theme music, and it did or did not help them.
It's funny, like, to just look back and think of themes and like you automatically equate a guy to a certain song. You know what I mean? Like, if you heard Goldberg's song like at a game or something, you would be like, oh my God, Goldberg's here. I even heard The Brood, oddly enough, at a college football game like 2 weeks ago. It's weird. They were playing it in the stadium. I was like, what the hell? Like, ready to go.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, whoa. But immediately I'm thinking Gangrel and The Brood and stuff. But it's funny, theme songs immediately, whether they're out, you know, somewhere else, like even Daniel Bryan's theme, sometimes I'm like, oh my God, is that Daniel Bryan's theme? The Flight of the Valkyrie? Like, you just think of him when you hear certain songs.
It's great. Absolutely. Flight of Valkyrie, or even when now a song that was massively popular is more attributed to the guy. When I hear fucking Hollywood Hogan theme, I'm not thinking
Voodoo Child.
Yeah. When I hear Voodoo Child, I think of fucking playing it on the belt and all that.
And running a circle around the ring and then going chop it down with the edge of my hand and the camera.
What we do all the time. Dude, he never did that. You know what I mean? Yep. Hendrix never did that during the show. But now every time it gets done in the song. So it's a crazy balance of even songs that we knew, but if we tie them to fictional moments in wrestling along with characters that we're very interested in, it's a powerful, powerful way to be in people's heart and soul who are dedicated to this stuff, because the music is a common bond that we all share. You know what I mean? And I blow my heat on Wednesday nights and Friday night at twitch.tv/Hamin Media and do the AEW and SmackDown Live self-help groups. And I just DJ a little bit, man. And they, you know, they block it afterwards, but I'm glad they don't pull my channel. Even though there's a bunch of shit on them right there, like, my turntables are over there and the records and all that for the ones and twos, man. So I think that they should do more with music. I love what they're doing with Hit Row. I even though I'm not a fan of, I think he's immature. What's the one kid who just jumped to AEW?
Leo Rush.
He's got musical talent. The kids from Acclaimed. Dude, that kid was so good. And getting heat in a real MC way, it got him heat in real life, and they fucking whitewashed him after that. terrible. Yeah. Like, you got to lean into that. That kid's got massive talent. He should be cutting the hottest mixtape off that little thing and be like, fuck you. You want to fuck with me? I'm about to make $250,000 as a SoundCloud rapper, bro. Like, get on your game and get on your hustle. And Swerve, that guy, he's got rhymes too. And, dude, this is the other thing. R-Truth just dropped a new one on Worldstar called Legendary, or Legend, I think. And it's like not this clowny shit that they do 24/7. That a thing like that can spin R-Truth out from the clown gimmick into what he was in TNA and give him one of his final runs. You know what I mean? Give him something meaningful as a IC champion. He's going to give you a fucking grade A match. He still looks incredible. He's got probably one of the best worker mindsets, and Vince trusts him. But we didn't use any of that shit to transition him to a higher character. Here's what I love about hip hop. And as far as wrestling training and acting training, hip hop and wrestling are the same thing. They're the fucking characters. Dr. Dre's really not out there shooting anybody. You know, Tupac maybe, but fucking other guys and whatnot, like Ice Cube isn't really going to fuck you up with an AK-47. I guarantee you. He just quit a $9 million movie. He's not going to do that. But they play this high level testosterone character that gets a response to it. When it comes to wrestling, we can learn from that and use some of that in that, and they steal from us. But learning how to rap gives you the ability to put a character in different voices and learn timing and rhythm and how to get words out and be fearless when you're doing it. Because a lot of people have fear of being front-footed and in their characters and getting it out. So if you can start emulating different rappers, from slower ones like Notorious Big to Bone Thugs and Harmony, who can do fucking 100 words in two seconds, you know, you're going to learn a lot about your vocal instrument, your ability to memorize lines, your ability to deliver in the moment disses, because hip hop is usually all setups and spikes, you know what I mean? Of like, and also wordplay that is multi-leveled in MC wizardry. So I think for actors, and I would have my teenage actors do this when I used to teach in Louisville, you got to memorize 16 bars, and everybody, I don't care if it's fucking some old school, she's dressed in yellow, he said, hello, come sitting next to me if I'm fella, right? Or if you want to do, you know, the most gangster shit that you want to, but you're going to learn what it feels like. And while you're doing it, I'm going to say, turn it up more. And then I'm going to put people behind you dancing so you feel more comfortable, so you're not out there doing it yourself. And now we're all working as a group with a group energy. And that part of music can really turn the key for somebody coming up as a performer and make them feel more confident in so many different ways. Hip hop is an underutilized tool in acting, and I think in wrestling promo class, to be honest with you.
Oh, wow. Interesting. But great stuff this week. Ben, of course, great to kind of do a little PW 101 with you, talking about wrestling themes. Yeah. Let's head towards the plugs. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Two Man Power Trip. Check out the website, tmptempire.com. Of course, Patreon, patreon.com/tmptempire. Ben, what do you got?
Yeah, man, we're at channelattitude.com, where I think you can go, and I'm sure it's in the library. It may not be uploaded yet. Maybe it is. Get it, Jeff Lane. But now I'm blanking on his name, the guy who wrote all the WWE songs.
Jim Johnston?
Yes. Then there's a great interview with him with Vince, and also you can look it up. My man, I am just botching names left and right here today.
Jeff Lane.
Oh, say Obi-Wan, you know me. The real, not RBV. That's the other guy, Billy Ray Valentine. I get RBVs and BRVs. That's why I get mixed up sometimes. Billy Ray Valentine has a great interview with him as well, man. So if you want to hear more, I didn't want to not include his name in this conversation. That guy, as well as, you know, Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, a great composer for wrestling themes as well, and whatnot. So those two guys obviously are two names we got to mention, even though we didn't go. I didn't want to do a history lesson. I'm not equipped to, when you can listen to Billy Ray Valentine or Vince Russo. Brand channelattitude.com and Hamin Media Group. I appreciate you guys subscribing over there through the holidays. I'm mixing things up at patreon.com/Hamin Media Group. I want to do Wu-Tang listen-alongs, a bunch of other type of marketing and improv and acting things along those lines. So you guys got your homework. You know what to do to hit us up at Two Man Power Trip at Ben_Hamin. I did some, cameos this week too, as a little birthday shout out. It was good times. Nice. cameo.com/Ben Hamin, man. But it's always fun talking about the biz with you. And man, hopefully I didn't ramble on too much this time on Pro Wrestling 101.
Nice. Thank you, Ben. As always, thank you, everybody, for listening. We'll see you right back here next week for a little PW 101. See you next week.